a come from a collective and interdisciplinary work start in 2016 with three computer scientists, Jean-Yves Ramel, Chauvel, and Ronan Guillaume, and two archaeologists, Xavier Rodier and me. The aim for this work in progress is to extract and to characterize linear archaeological features. This collaboration was born in the SOLIDAR program that I did with Xavier in my lab. And this program is funded by the Région Centre-Val-de-Loire, the Domaine National de Chambord, and the Ministry of Culture in the Région Centre-Val-de-Loire. The SOLIDAR program brings together researchers from several fields: archaeology, history, geology, biology, and computer scientists, and members of the Domaine National de Chambord and the French National Office for Forests. It aims to establish protocols adapted to the understanding of environmental and cultural dynamics to enable the diachronic study of land use. It crosses remote sensing data and archaeological written, geomorphological and ecological sources. After creating our software last year, we took advantage of this year to improve its accessibility and performance. We set specification at the beginning of our research, namely that the system should use the machine learning, that it should be able to provide a probability map rather than yes/no information, and finally that the system should be able to characterize the detected elements. In addition, the process needed to be flexible enough to accommodate different types of data and remains. And finally, we really wanted this system to be user-friendly so that it could be used by many archaeologists as possible. Our principal study area is shown here in red. It is located around the city of Blois and the castle of Chambord, mainly of the left bank of the Loire River. In this sector, the forest from a surface almost 25,000 hectares that covered 80% of the LIDAR acquisition area, in which the Chambord estate was created between 1522 and 1650. The earliest mention of this forest dates of 1215. As it has already been said, and as it will be said all along the day, the LIDAR or ALS remote sensing technique is very useful to organize micro-relief under the forest, and micro-relief was particularly well preserved in forest. The LIDAR technology makes it possible to generate highly accurate elevation models from the ground, whatever the nature of the plant cover. So actually we are working on different data sets and we use a topographic position index with an annulus of 6 meters to 20 meters, on a DTM with a resolution of 2 meters, and a local relief model with a resolution of 1 meter. So, the raw LIDAR data analysis revealed that in the forest concerned by our program, there is a lot of different types of archaeological features that have particular microtopographic signatures. We can note that in addition to ditches and old paths, where is the old path? Ici. There is at least 3 plots from overlapping. You can see in the foreground the curved plot frame system with the modern road. This frame overlaps a system of embankments and ditches. And this system consists of rectangular, square or polygonal modules who are embedded or not. In section, these structures are composed by an embankment and a ditch. These elements are still well recognizable on the field and were identified by field working before the LIDAR survey. You can notice that this system overlaps a third system composed only by embankments. These elements are 15 meters wide for 10 to 15 centimeters high. Okay, of course, the human eye is unable to recognize this artifact on the field. And this system is composed by tiny rectangular parcels. The obvious overlap between these three plot frames give us a beginning of a relative chronology. The embankment system corresponding to an open landscape dedicated probably to about pastoral activities is the oldest. The dating of the archaeological sites linked to the frame and the OSL dating of this structure indicate an occupation from the proto-historical period to the Middle Age. The embankment ditch system is not clearly dated. The tradition attributes it to the 12th century, but we do not have a reliable chronology indication. The system is probably, like the actual one, dedicated to hunting and forestry activities. In total, more than 2,000 kilometers, of phenomena have been vectorized manually inside the studied area. The detection and analysis of this linear structure are one of the main issues of the work in the SOLIDAR program. And in addition, the National Geographic Institute has recently launched a microtopographic coverage for the entire Centre Val-de-Loire region. And this data, with a resolution of 1 meter, covered an area of 40,000 square kilometers, of which 10,000 square kilometers is covered by forest. Of course, the visual analysis and the manual vectorization is a tedious task. So we try to extract automatically the linear structure from the LiDAR data with the method of image analysis. After trying to use the classical image processing technique, pixel analysis, object analysis, we examine a semi-automated method based on machine learning in order to define a more flexible and robust framework for a better characterization of archaeological structures from LiDAR derivatives. The main idea of such approach is to find a clever way to combine information coming from the DEM in order to decide for each pixel if it is a part of a specific element of interest. You can see here the main step of the process, the selection of the class, the processing of picture, the creation of learning sample, and the feature selection. The main difference from last year, if you have already seen this kind of presentation, are due to the work of the optimization protocol. We included this year multi-threading, the indexing of data, and the addition of a sequential forward floating selection, and an addition of a new feature, but I will talk about later. The idea for the design of this system is, as I said, to propose a free and open system that ensures that it is able to adapt to the various archaeological sites or structures. Furthermore, the provided decision for each pixel should be not binary one, yes or no, black or white, but a set of probabilities corresponding to the chance for the pixel to be part of each possible class. We wanted that this system could sweat multiple class, generate probability map, and use this parameter in order to detect or characterize the relays. Before all, when designing a classification system, the selection of the feature to describe the pixel, as well as the context of the training data set, are extremely important because they determine the quality of the classification results. So the first step is to select the input image that will be used to compute the pixel feature. And based on our expertise, for the major part of the test, we use a DTM with a resolution of 2 meters and another DTM with a resolution of 1 meter. We compute topographic position index or local relief model on this DTM. And we transform all this derivative picture in an 8-byte picture. And we draw for each class a 2-byte picture, presence-absence. To characterize each pixel, we have actually implemented 64 features, by example, the intensity of the central point or the value of the mean pixel in a size variable matrix. And we think that it will be efficient to leave the choice for each operator to use an automatic choice of feature or to select a feature manually. So actually, we have implemented a sequential forward floating selection method. For the classification, different machine learning algorithms can be adopted and plugged into our framework. And for the moment, we only incorporate SVM classifier inside the system. The SVM is a non-parametric kernel-based technique based on the statistical learning theory, optimization algorithm, and structural risk minimization theory. And of course, it has been used in many studies. So the SVM parameter optimization can be done using an n-fold cross-validation grid search function. But in this study, a radial basis function kernel was used, and the cost and the gamma parameter to be optimized empirically. So the SVM generates support vector in red, with able to separate class following different parameters. On the example of the left side, you can notice that it is easy to differentiate the class with two parameters when you look at 100 samples. However, it's much more difficult to define the support vector if the sample size increases. In order to correct this fact, we increase the dimension number in order to work in an n-dimension space with kernel radial basis function. I will not talk about the results. For this test, we use 30,000 samples in order to generate the learning base of SVM. It's important to note that all the classes are the same size, and we integrated the other classes, corresponding to everything else. The SVM parameters are presented, but please don't ask me how the different parameters work. And the results are displayed in the confusion matrix. So the percentage corresponds to remain detected in each class. By example, if you look at the second line, 23% of ancient pathways are detected as other. 28%, pardon. 28% as ancient pathways, 7% as each, etc. As you can see, finally, the error rate is near 60% if we take account of all the classes we define. And the class with the poorest results is the ancient pathway because we think it's really difficult to detect even by an expert. So finally, we try now to remove it from our data. Second problem is the confusion between the modern pathway and the embankment ditch. So it's normal because the modern pathways are composed by border, embankments, and ditch. By the way, the first result on the embankments detection are particularly encouraging. So now we are concentrating on this type of remains, and now we have a detection range of this kind of remains near than 70%. Okay. On the left, you can see an embankment system, and on the right, this is the probability of each pixel to be an embankment. The black color corresponding to 100% probability. You can notice that the biggest probability corresponds to the biggest remains, and by the way, the detection of the smaller feature isn't so evident. The analysis of this kind of picture helps us to understand the SVM process and to improve the system. We can also map all the classes. In this case, each pixel class corresponds to the highest probability. On this example, we had fun classifying three types of objects, ditches, embankments, and ditches embankments. If we exclude the whole paths which have been interpreted as embankments, just here, the results are rather encouraging, and we can note, as on the previous image, that the no vestige class works well, rather well. So, this work is an attempt to develop generic machine learning framework from the semi-automatic extraction of archaeological elements based on the LiDAR DEM. Since the beginning of the work, we took time to design a stable and efficient system to extract and detect the features. Now we can really focus on improving the system. Okay, you can look, have a look at the extraction of the interface machine human, interface human machine. We are on the end of the debugging, and we hope to be able to propose this summer a system that, if some people are interested to test and make us return, it will be a pleasure. The objective of this process, as well as the following point, is obviously to increase the detection rate. So we still wish to add new features and to have the possibility to exploit several data derived from LiDAR. We also want to increase the efficiency of the SVM, which is the last one. We have foreseen the possibility of adding a convolutional neural network usage, but we are still thinking about its interest in our dataset. And these improvements will allow us to work on a larger dataset. Finally, and I will end here, I did not talk about the vectorization and information, which is obviously a task that must be working on. And thank you for listening.